The next part of our training then is to go through all of the 11 classes of substances and pick up things such as what is their mechanism of action, how do they work in the brain, and how do they affect the brain and the body, and to give you a little bit of history perhaps about each of the substances. Now, you've seen this slide before, and you remember the reward circuit right there in the center of the brain. So that is the circuit that is affected. This part of the talk is going to cover the first five things: the stimulants, caffeine, nicotine, cannabis, and opioids. We will also have time to talk about bath salts, which fit into the stimulants category, and we'll talk about K2 or spice, which fits into the cannabis category. So this is a, you know, you hopefully will get some information about drugs of abuse that you may not be as familiar with. So what are the stimulants? So the stimulants are the uppers, things that make the person feel up, energetic, okay, as opposed to the downers. So we'll talk about those two. So the stimulants include amphetamine, which is the prototype stimulant, cocaine, which at least in this area of the country is the most commonly used stimulant, and it includes crack, methamphetamine, which is sort of like the first cousin of amphetamine, and it includes things like crank and ice, methylphenidate, which is Ritalin, which is used to treat ADHD, that is a stimulant, ephedrine, which is found in medications used to treat colds and coughs. You can buy, well, you used to be able to buy them over the counter. Now you actually got to go to the pharmacy desk and show your license, and then they'll sell you a box of them. What was happening was people were taking the ephedrine, they were buying 25 boxes of it, they were taking it home, and they were turning it into methamphetamine. So there's recipes on the internet for how to turn one drug into another, and so that's what people were doing. So they had to move those drugs from regular to behind the counter. And then there's something called khat, K-H-A-T, which is a stimulant that's found in a plant in the Middle East. So those are all, these are all examples of stimulants. So how are all of the stimulants alike? Well, all of the stimulants have what's called sympathomimetic activity, which means that they increase your heart rate, they increase your blood pressure, they increase your body temperature. So they turn on or they turn up your system. And they all cause euphoria, they all make you feel high. They can be taken in a variety of ways. You can eat them, you can put them in your nose, which is IN, stands for intranasal. You can put them in your veins, IV, stands for intravenous, or you can smoke them the way that you smoke crack. So the reinforcing effects, the reason that the stimulants are used over and over again is because of the dopamine effects in the nucleus accumbens. Stimulants do cause tolerance and cross-tolerance. So tolerance again means you take more to get the same effect. Cross-tolerance means that if you're addicted to stimulants and you don't, excuse me, if you're addicted to amphetamine and you run out of your supply of amphetamine, well then cocaine will do the trick just about as well, so that the different drugs in the class are cross-tolerant with each other. Now, stimulants actually do have some medical uses. There's actually a reason that doctors would prescribe stimulants. Those reasons are listed on this slide. ADD, attention deficit disorder, is a big reason that somebody might be taking a stimulant. Narcolepsy, which is a neurological disorder where the person falls asleep just in the middle of just walking around or driving, they can fall asleep suddenly. Narcolepsy can be treated with stimulants. Treatment-resistant depression can be treated with stimulants. Back in the 70s and 80s, and sometimes rarely right now, people treat obesity with stimulants because they suppress your appetite. But I put yikes there because I think that's a very scary way to treat obesity. What you end up doing is getting addicted to the stimulant. So, and then of course, local anesthesia. So cocaine and other drugs like cocaine actually are numbing agents. And so there are still emergency rooms in this country, I don't know if there are any in Cleveland, that say you have a really bad nosebleed and the blood just won't stop coming. They can put a little bit of cocaine with along with a couple of other drugs and stuff that with some gauze up your nose, and that will stop the bleeding, and it'll be like a local anesthetic. So again, not probably the best way to stop a bloody nose. Okay, so on this slide is a list of what are the things that happen when you're intoxicated or taking too much of the drug. That's the left-hand slide. And then on the right-hand side of the slide are what happens to you when you're in withdrawal. And in general, and you'll see this pattern over and over again as we go through the different classes of drugs, you know, the things that happen in withdrawal are the opposite of the things that happen in intoxication, okay? So with intoxication, with a stimulant, again, you get euphoric. You get very happy. You can get agitated and violent. You are unable to sleep, and you don't feel like eating. That's the anorexia. That's how stimulants make you lose weight. You just don't feel like eating. And again, all the other things that you can see listed on there, some of the scarier things are at the bottom of the list, like paranoia, hallucinations, hyperthermia, seizures, and strokes. And then on the withdrawal side, if you stop taking the cocaine or stop taking the speed or stop taking the Ritalin, you can get all of the things on the right-hand side. And so, of course, you would get sad, you would get very tired, you would get hypersomnia, which means sleeping too much, you would get hyperphagia, which means eating too much, bradycardia means that your heart rate would slow down. So again, all the opposite things that you would see, and of course, you'd have intense craving. The next slide basically shows you a picture of where in the brain cocaine works. And you'll see that this picture will change slightly as we go through the different classes. But cocaine is pretty much relegated right to the ventral tegmental area and the nucleus accumbens and a little bit in that area above. That's where the cocaine is really focused. You'll see with other drugs like alcohol and marijuana that the whole brain is affected. But here, we're just relegated just to that reward circuit that we talked about. And this is similar to what you saw in the last presentation, where that a person that's on cocaine, which is the brain on the right, doesn't have as robust of good functioning brain activity as the brain on the left, which has much more of the red and the orange. You can see that that's diminished on the right-hand side. So let's get into some of the specific stimulants. We talked about them in general. So cocaine is a specific stimulant that tends to be used in a binge crash pattern. So you use a whole lot, use till all the money's gone, and then you crash out. That's what happens. There are multiple medical complications of cocaine. Those are listed on there. These are some of the most common. I mean, there's probably like 50 or 100. This is the top 10. So you can really mess up your nose, especially if you're taking the cocaine in intranasally. Some people have basically, because the cocaine constricts the blood vessels, you can kill the skin that's in between your two nostrils and you can have holes. You can have a perforation in your nasal septum. You can certainly have seizures and strokes and heart attacks, sometimes fatal. You can, if you're using the cocaine IV, which some people do, you can have infections of your heart and your skin, and you can also pass along hepatitis B, hepatitis C, and HIV, and cocaine has been implicated in many suicides and homicides. So there are different forms of taking it. The cocaine hydrochloride is the white powder that is snorted or injected. The crack or the freebase form of cocaine is what is smoked. And the coca leaf, which we don't do this here, they do it in South America, the coca leaf is what is chewed. And what's interesting, when you chew it, it doesn't give you a really, really high high and a really big crash. When you chew it, you just get this nice little bump in your mood and in your energy level. And I kind of think of it as that's their form of caffeine. So down there, they chew the coca leaves to keep themselves going the way that we drink caffeine to keep ourselves going. So, but that's the three ways of using it. If you smoke it, that produces a high that happens within seconds, and it lasts about a half hour. And then it's gone, and you need that feeling again. So of course, you have that intense crash, and you then need to use again. So that's cocaine. Methamphetamine, or speed, also works in that reward pathway of the brain. What's interesting about methamphetamine is what's on the right-hand side of the slide. Methamphetamine stimulates the release of too much dopamine. So the dopamine is in the little circles. The methamphetamine is the little triangles. When the triangles come into the system, then those little bubbles break open and they release all the dopamine into the space between the nerves. So methamphetamine, we don't have a huge methamphetamine problem in Cleveland. Methamphetamine is much more likely to be found in southern Ohio and other parts of the country, like San Diego, Hawaii, and Texas are very famous for having big methamphetamine problems. But it is increasing in many rural areas, including the southern part of our state. The reason we don't have a lot of methamphetamine in Cleveland is because we have cocaine and crack. So we're just using a different stimulant up here. 4% of the United States population has tried methamphetamine, so that's approximately 1 out of 20 people. And methamphetamine, like I had alluded to earlier, can be made by taking those over-the-counter cold pills and some other readily available things that you can buy at the store. And I was even at a presentation recently where they have a new method where they can take a 2-liter bottle, mix everything up in the 2-liter bottle, just shake it. It's called the shake and bake method. They just shake it up and then it forms the drugs that they can then use. Whereas before they had to get set up a big lab in their garage or their basement or their bathtub, and then those methamphetamine labs would be the ones that, you know, would blow up and then you'd hear about them on the news. So they don't have to do the methamphetamine labs the way they used to. They can just use the quick shake and bake method. So interesting. So methamphetamine, like cocaine, is also used in a binge crash pattern. There is a rapid onset of action when you smoke it. Interestingly, the high lasts a lot longer than the half hour. The high actually lasts 12 to 14 hours. And the problem with speed is that it can cause a long-lasting psychosis. So most people that say start to get paranoid or psychotic off of the cocaine, that's going to go away within about a day, day and a half. If you get psychotic and hear voices and stuff and get real paranoid off of the methamphetamine, that can actually last an extremely long time, and you can be so sick that you can never come back from it. That happens to people sometimes. So it can cause substantial damage to your dopamine nerves, even in a relatively low dose. And again, the crash when you get off of this stuff is very severe. So is there anything you can do to treat stimulant withdrawal? Stimulant withdrawal by itself, say that that's the only thing that they're using. Stimulant withdrawal by itself is psychologically uncomfortable, but it is not life-threatening. There are some medicines that you can use, but they're moderately helpful at best, and they're actually not really FDA approved for that use. Sometimes we just try to give people something like a low dose of trazodone, or give them something that's to help them sleep, or maybe give them something like amantadine to help with cravings. So it's moderately helpful at best. What you have to be aware of is that many individuals addicted to stimulants are also addicted to other drugs that can have a dangerous withdrawal, and we'll talk about that as we go along. So alcohol and the benzos are the two classes of drugs that do have the most dangerous withdrawal. So a lot of times people that use cocaine also use those other two. So you might be having to treat withdrawal from other drugs. All right, so we said that bath salts are the hot new thing. This is a new epidemic that we have. I think we're coming down off the epidemic because the feds have cracked down and the state of Ohio has passed laws. But every few days, I still hear a story of somebody that was using bath salts. So it hasn't gone away totally. So bath salts, the first thing I need to tell you is that they're not really bath salts. You do not put them into your bath to smell good. They are marketed as bath salts. The other way that they are marketed is as plant fertilizer. Okay, so this is the reason that they're marketed this way is to skirt the laws. So they are labeled not for human consumption, which helps them skirt this federal law called the Analog Act, under which any substance that's similar to a banned drug is deemed illegal if it's intended for consumption. So the manufacturers just say this is not intended for human consumption. But the head shops and the convenience stores and the gas stations where you used to be able to get them very readily, like just last summer, they just go ahead and sell them right out in the open. So bath salts were sweeping, you know, Britain, England, and those got banned there in April of 2010. They came into our country usually through the port of New Orleans via India and China. Earlier this year, the Drug Enforcement Agency, the DEA, listed this drug, MDPV, and I'll tell you what that means, but bath salts are basically a mixture of MDPV and other substances. They listed it as a drug of concern. As of September 7th, 2011, The DEA basically put an emergency ban on these substances, both MDPV and mefedrone, and they are deciding right now on whether or not to permanently control these substances. And then the state law has also come into play, and you can see that it was July of 2011, so just about a year ago, that Ohio became one of the states that lists synthetic cathinones or bath salts as a controlled substance. So that was a short list of some of the states that have sort of said, okay, this is illegal. So the next set of slides shows you some examples of what happens to people on bath salts. Back in October of last year, House Bill 64 was signed into law, and that made it a crime to sell or possess bath salts. And there was a young lady in Elyria who, I have her name for you there. Allison Hughes became the first person arrested in Elyria under the bath salts law. She was pulled over on a routine traffic stop, and she was caught with, you know, a couple packages of the bath salts. So the Elyria police were quoted as saying that bath salts are becoming a growing problem. People are actually jumping out of second story windows, acting very irrational. And if you were around for when PCP was around and was really hot in the 70s and the early 80s, to me, it reminded me of those stories of people high on PCP. So Dayton has reported 5 deaths on bath salts, and one of the clinicians in Dayton said, if you take PCP, cocaine, methamphetamine, and kind of wrap them up together, then you have bath salts. She said that people get paranoid, delusional, extreme hallucinations like seeing werewolves and believing that the hospital staff is trying to harm them. So this is some pretty nasty stuff. So what is it? What is the MDPV? It's actually a chemical called methylene dioxypyrovalerone. Okay, that's a nice tongue twister. And interestingly, it's nothing new. It was developed in the 60s for, guess what, to treat fatigue and to make you lose weight. This is a weight loss agent. And they knew back in the 60s that it caused problems with dependency and abuse. So it has effects that are similar to cocaine. So the products, the actual bath salts, have the MDPV, or they have something known as 4-methylmethcathinone, otherwise known as mefedrone. And both of these drugs, the MDPV and the mefedrone, are actually related to cot, which I mentioned long ago. And cot is that stimulant that's found in the Arabic and East African countries. And cot is also illegal in the United States, but you can also get it here as well. So MDPV has chemically similar to Ritalin and ecstasy. And it's also a norepinephrine, which is another neurotransmitter, a norepinephrine and dopamine reuptake inhibitor. And it has been compared with Ritalin at low doses and cocaine at high doses. So it has some fancy, fun names like Ivory Wave. I mean, this stuff really does sound like soap, like Cloud 9, like Pure Ivory, like White Dove. So different kinds of names. White Lightning, they call it, I think, in Kentucky. So just depending on where you are in the country, the bath salts have different names. Caffeine, interestingly, in the DSM-4, they only describe caffeine intoxication. They say that there is no such thing as caffeine withdrawal. But for any of us that have ever tried to take ourselves off caffeine, we might disagree with what the book says. So in caffeine intoxication, you can get things like anxiety, agitation, restlessness, inability to sleep, and then some of the withdrawal symptoms that happen when people get off of high levels of caffeine, most commonly is headache, and they sleep a lot, and they may feel dysphoric or unhappy. So most people use caffeine without any major issues or problems, so there isn't any caffeine abuse or dependence per se. So the only ones I wanted to talk about were really the intoxication or the withdrawal. You're not really seeing a lot of, you know, someone who's a caffeine addict, so to speak. Well, again, Some people might differ on that. So let's move on to nicotine. So nicotine intoxication and withdrawal. With nicotine, and interestingly, again, sort of the flip-flop of the one I just showed you, there is no such thing as nicotine intoxication in DSM-4. What is described is nicotine withdrawal. So you can have that. Nicotine, again, is, I think, one of the drugs that it isn't paid a lot of attention to, I guess I would say, which is kind of sad and not a good thing because it really kills more than any of the other drugs that we're going to talk about here today combined. And so really we ought to be spending a whole lot more time talking about nicotine and how to help our patients and clients get off of it if possible. So just to give you some sense of the numbers, if you look at street drugs, they perhaps kill 60,000 people per year. Alcohol, in the neighborhood of 100,000 people per year that die of alcohol-related causes. But nicotine kills easily 450,000 people per year. So it is an amazing drug, and it is probably one of the most addictive drugs that we have. I mean, if you just looking straight at the science, nicotine's actually more addictive than cocaine, which is interesting because it's completely legal and we use taxes on it to build things everywhere in this country. So nicotine also, and use of tobacco and smoking cigarettes also interferes with people with mental illness who may be on lots of medication. So I'm going to walk you through a few slides. Some people may complain that they're on too much medication, and if they're also smokers, that might be one of the reasons, because tobacco use interferes with the breakdown of their medications, and so they need higher doses of medicines to get a therapeutic effect. What tobacco use does is it causes you to break down the medicines that you're taking at a faster rate. So here's a list of psychiatric medications that can be interfered with by smoking cigarettes. So it's a pretty long list, anywhere from Haldol, Zyprexa, all the way to some of the antidepressants, et cetera. So, and there's other medical medications that tobacco use also interferes with, including some important things like blood thinners, Tylenol, insulin, Coumadin, those kind of things. So it does interfere with the breakdown of many medications. The other thing that tobacco use can do is it can actually lead in some direct and indirect ways to diabetes. So tobacco use in and of itself increases insulin resistance, which means that the insulin doesn't do what it's supposed to do as well. And because the tobacco interferes with the metabolism of prescription medications, you need higher doses of those medications, which can then cause weight gain and can then cause diabetes. So there are both direct and indirect ways. There's also a tobacco and obesity connection. Again, if you need higher doses of a medication such as, for example, Zyprexa, and then as you take that higher dose, you get more weight gain and you also get more sedation. Both of those factors can contribute to obesity. And finally, and of course, premature death. Tobacco use is related to cardiovascular disease, respiratory illnesses like COPD and asthma, diabetes, cancer, and accidents. There are somewhere in the neighborhood of 1,500 people who die because they were smoking while they were in bed and they set a fire. So there are people who die accidentally of their smoking habit. So they're not trying to die, that's just an accident. So some people, when they look at people with serious mental illness, like schizophrenia, that there may be some perceived positives or things that might be a good thing when it comes to tobacco. And for sure, nicotine, which is the drug in question, nicotine does improve some cognitive symptoms in schizophrenia, but only in the short term, only for like 20 minutes. And for some people, nicotine could have some theoretical antidepressant effects. So there are some implications when a person does have serious mental illness, but overall, what we do know about tobacco is that tobacco is untested for all of those effects, and its lethality is unquestionable. There are much safer treatments available. I mean, tobacco is one of those things that if you use it exactly the way you're supposed to use it, it will kill 50% of its users. So it's amazing to me that something like that is legal. You know, you use it the way you're supposed to, and it'll kill half of people that use it. So long-term smoking can cause cognitive problems, including memory loss, decreased problem-solving ability, and even loss of IQ points. And when you look at alcoholics who smoke versus alcoholics who do not smoke, alcoholics who smoke have more cerebral atrophy, which is shrinking of the brain. So, like I said, tobacco is probably the one thing that we don't spend enough time on as a system dealing with. So let's switch gears a little bit and talk about marijuana. Marijuana is still the most widely used illegal drug in the United States. At least 30% of the population, so one out of three of us, has tried marijuana, which is about 80 to 100 million people. The effects of marijuana tend to be situation dependent. Marijuana is usually smoked. It can be taken in by mouth. The active ingredient is something called Delta 9 THC. And as I alluded to way earlier on in our conversation, endogenous cannabinoid receptors have been identified, which means that in our brains, we have natural marijuana and we have marijuana receptors, so cannabis receptors. There is tolerance that can develop. There may be some cross-tolerance with alcohol. Here's the picture of the brains that I was showing you before. We still see the pink dots represent the marijuana and where its receptors and where it affects the brain. And of course, we still see that it's highlighted in the reward pathway, but you can also see that it's all throughout the cortex as well as in the cerebellum. So it's in a lot of different places in the brain, say as compared to cocaine, but it still does have its final focus is on dopamine. So what does cannabis intoxication and withdrawal look like? Right now, cannabis intoxication is in the DSM-4. Cannabis withdrawal is not in the DSM-4, but it is planned for the DSM-5. So everything that I've heard says that, yes, cannabis withdrawal is real, and it's probably going to make it into the DSM-5. So again, when you're intoxicated or high on cannabis, you are happy, you are sedated. It's an anti-emetic, which means that it prevents you, it decreases your nausea, prevents you from throwing up. You eat a lot. You have memory deficits. You certainly have the red eyes, which is known as the conjunctival injection. You can have ptosis, which is where your eyelids drop a little bit. You can have an increase in your heart rate, and some people can actually get psychotic from smoking weed. So, and then the withdrawal symptoms there are listed for you. And I just want to show you one study that they did on marijuana withdrawal. And so what you see in the line on the top is long-term daily smokers. There was, this is a small study, 17 of those folks, and there were infrequent or former smokers of marijuana. There were 20 of those. And what they basically showed in sort of a psychological study is that the people that were long-term marijuana smokers that were put into marijuana withdrawal actually elicited some aggressive behavior, so that you could see that they had, you know, double or triple the amount of aggressive responses as opposed to the people who were infrequent users of marijuana. Marijuana does have some potential medical uses. There's lots of stuff going on that you hear in the news about medical marijuana, and that, you know, tends to be a very controversial issue. Some of the potential medical uses of marijuana include when chemo patients get very nauseous, when AIDS patients lose a lot of weight and they have wasting, possibly useful in spasticity, glaucoma, and some pain syndromes. And I guess I'll say just a little bit about the whole medical marijuana debate. What people, I think, are arguing about is whether or not the smoking of marijuana should be considered medicine versus marijuana in a pill form, which we've already had for years. So the debate is about whether or not the smokable form should be considered to be, quote, medication. So the debate rages on. Ohio was trying to put it on its ballot for this November, and luckily, at least I think luckily, they weren't able to get enough signatures. So it will not appear on the ballot, but you know, we've already got, what, half a dozen states around the country that are going that way, so I don't think it's anything that's going to go away. I think future elections, it'll probably find its way on the ballot, and then it'll be up to Ohioans to decide whether or not medical smoked marijuana is going to become a medical, quote, treatment. So lots of people feel that marijuana is a harmless drug, and that's why I think so many people use it. In my opinion, as an addictionologist, it's not a harmless drug. It can cause a toxic psychosis. They have many studies already that show that heavy users of marijuana are more likely to develop schizophrenia, which, as you know, is a lifelong illness. It can cause panic reactions. It has been found in 10% of fatal accident victims. It can impair your immune function, and it increases your risk of a heart attack. So certainly not as harmless as people make it out to be. It does contain more cancer-causing agents than tobacco. Bronchitis is very common. Chronic bronchitis is very common amongst people that smoke marijuana. There is an increased risk of the lung, head, and neck cancers. And then, of course, substantial motivational and cognitive deficits. So that's my little spiel on marijuana. There is also what is out on the market. Right around the time that bath salts came out was something called K2 and spice. And when you would read the news, they would lump K2, spice, and bath salts all in the same breath as if they were the same class of drug. They absolutely are not. The bath salts are firmly in the stimulant category, and K2 and spice are like synthetic cannabis. So totally different drugs and totally different ways of working. So spice first appeared in Europe in 2004. In March of last year, the DEA did ban the five chemicals that are most commonly found in spice, and those five chemicals are listed for you there. The DEA reports that when people use K2 or spice, that has led to a surge in ER visits and poison control center calls. And there are multiple adverse health effects that are listed for you there, including seizures, hallucinations, paranoia, agitation, and anxiety. You can get a racing heartbeat and elevated blood pressure. So the same law that banned the bath salts also banned the K2 and spice in Ohio. So hopefully over time you'll see less and less of this, but I dare say it's still going on and you can still get it if you want it. So, you know, just because you have a law saying it's illegal doesn't mean you can't get it. I mean, look at all the other drugs. So now we'll move on to opioids. So opioids is a huge, huge class of drugs. I'm only showing you sort of the tip of the iceberg here. I wanted to show you on this slide that there are three kinds of opioids to be aware of. Well, actually two kinds of opioids to be aware of, and one that's an anti-opiate. So let's talk about those things. The opioid agonists are listed on the left side. Agonist meaning that it turns the receptor on. The opioid antagonists are the anti-opiates. They are things that turn the receptor off. And then you have something that's in between, which is known as a partial agonist or a mixed agonist antagonist. So things like morphine, heroin, OxyContin, things like that are the things that turn the receptor on. The two that turn the receptor off are naloxone and naltrexone. And then the thing that's in the mixed category is buprenorphine, also known as Suboxone. So you may have met some folks that are using that. So of course, opioid medications, we couldn't practice modern medicine without the opiates. So we need these in our system. But the problem is that they can cause all kinds of problems with addiction. So we do use the opiates every day in the treatment of acute and severe pain in our medical system, but opioid abuse and dependence have been problematic for hundreds of years. It's nothing new. There are several classes of people who abuse opiates. There are the street abusers, which usually are using heroin. There are the medical abusers, which are using the pills. And then there are methadone patients. So, who sometimes, well, actually, some methadone patients are actually using it legitimately to treat their addiction, and then there are other patients who are misusing their methadone. There are many different ways to take opiates. Actually, I think this is the one with the most ways that you can take it compared to all other drugs. So oral, intravenous, intramuscular, subcutaneous, intranasal, smoking, and per rectum. So you can take opiates in many different ways, okay? The effects of the opiates are mediated through your natural opiate receptors. There are at least four different kinds of opiate receptors, the mu, the kappa, the sigma, and the delta. Kind of sounds like a fraternity or something. But the mu receptor is the one that's the most important. It's the mu receptor that causes the pain relief. It's the mu receptor that also causes the addiction and the happiness. So, and then you can see that the other receptors cause some other things. There is certainly tolerance and cross-tolerance with these medications. And similar to the way that I showed you with the other drugs of abuse, here's the opiates in the light blue, and it shows you on the slide where they appear in the brain, also widely distributed in the cortex. The next slide shows you the opioid intoxication and withdrawal. So the things that happen when you're high on opiates is that you get sleepy. So first you get happy, and then you get sleepy, and then you get slurred speech, and you can also have constipation, and your breathing slows down, and in the case of people who OD, your breathing actually stops. So that's how opiate overdose kills you. It basically stops your breathing. So the opposite of all of that is the withdrawal. So during the withdrawal phase, you've got nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea. You cannot sleep. You are extremely unhappy and anxious, and you get the chills. You get yawning, and you get muscle and joint pain and sweats. It's basically like having the worst flu of your life, and you're also craving opiates. That's what opioid withdrawal is like. So you can treat opiate withdrawal. It is very uncomfortable, but 99% of the time it won't kill you. It's just that when you're in the middle of it, you will wish that you were dead. So there are a few ways to treat it. You can treat it with clonidine, you can treat it with methadone, or you can treat it with Suboxone. So we'll talk about the clonidine first. Clonidine is basically a blood pressure medicine that also happens to treat some of the symptoms of opiate withdrawal. So I showed you how to dose the medication. It's 0.1 to 0.3 milligrams three times a day or four times a day. And then you can go up to 1.2 milligrams on the second day. And then you keep the person on it for 5 to 10 days, usually more closer to 5 days, and then you bring them off of that medicine. You do have to be aware, though, that because it's a heart medicine or a blood pressure medicine, it can cause low blood pressure and it can slow your heart rate down a lot. So you do have to be careful with the clonidine. The other things that people get when they're in opiate withdrawal are all kinds of, I'll call them extra medications, basically just for symptom relief. So you're gonna give them ibuprofen, you're gonna give them something for diarrhea, you might give them a low dose of like a benzo, you might give them something for nausea and vomiting. What they do say is avoid using needles, particularly in someone who was shooting their heroin. So the second way to treat opiate, or the second major medication that you can use to treat opiate withdrawal, which does require a special license, is methadone. So what you do is you give enough methadone on day one that they're in withdrawal to make them comfortable. Rarely is that a dose over 40 milligrams in the first 24 hours. You usually want to start with a small test dose of 5 to 10 milligrams. And then what you want to do is once you've gotten them to that dose that they're going to be on, you want to taper it over a 10-day period. So you have to be cautious with this, though, because as little as 40 milligrams of oral methadone can be fatal. So you got to sort of know what you're doing when you're trying to treat people with people in opiate withdrawal with methadone. The third way to treat people in opiate withdrawal is to use buprenorphine or Suboxone. This is a drug that's been around now for 10 years. It came out in 2002. It is used in addiction treatment, and you can use it both for withdrawal and for maintenance, and the same is true for methadone. You can use methadone both for withdrawal as well as maintenance treatment. The form that's most commonly used is actually a combination of two medications, buprenorphine and naloxone. And the reason that there's two medications in one is as follows. So the government built it that way so that if the person tried to abuse the Suboxone, what they would try to do is like crush it up and try to shoot it IV. What happens when you shoot it IV is that the naloxone part of it becomes activated and throws you into a horrible opiate withdrawal. So most likely if you ever try that, you're not going to try it again. So they were trying to make it that way to make it less abusable. If you take it the way you're supposed to, which is melt it under your tongue, then the naloxone part is completely inactive and you're only getting the buprenorphine. So the reason that the naloxone is there is to prevent people from abusing it by using, you know, crushing it up and putting it into a needle for intravenous use. So the nice things about Suboxone are that there are less risks of abuse and it's less dangerous than some of the other things that we use to treat this illness. But the drawback to it is that you have to have a special certificate and have to have gone through an 8-hour training before you can prescribe this stuff, which I happen to find ironic because you don't need any training for OxyContin, and you can prescribe OxyContin to as many patients as you want, and that's any physician. Whereas if you want to prescribe Suboxone, you have to have the 8-hour course, and you can only treat a maximum of 100 patients. So I just think that's very backwards. Let me just leave it at that. So this last slide then just shows you a typical protocol of how you would treat somebody that's in opiate withdrawal using the Suboxone. So you could either give it to somebody for about, you know, 3 to 5 days, or you can give it to them sort of ongoing as maintenance treatment. Some people are sort of very afraid or mistrustful of Suboxone or methadone because they say, oh my gosh, you're just getting them addicted to something else. And actually what you're doing is they are becoming physically dependent on that, but all of the behaviors of the addiction, or most of the behaviors of the addiction, actually go away. And so I do have patients currently in my practice that have been on Suboxone for 5 to 7 years, and they've been taking it every day, very similar to a way that somebody would take insulin every day. And they're doing absolutely fine with it. They haven't used heroin in 7 years. So to me, that's a success story. Other people sort of look at that and say, well, I don't know if that's the best thing. Well, you know, I kind of look at being on Suboxone for 7 years as better than being off and on heroin for years and years. That's one person's opinion. So